Many are called, but few are chosen. In Miami, some years ago, there was a beautification program. There were 25 folks on the committee, but more people wanted to be involved. And so 130 more wanted to be included in that beautification committee in the great city of Miami. And they were appointed. And at the first meeting, only 19 showed up. Where are the other 137? Where are the other 137? Well, we know that Americans, in relation to most countries in the world, particularly in the West, we are a very religious country. The polls show that we are 80% plus folks confessing they believe in God, but yet, and this is pre-COVID, so it's even worse than that now, but only 38% of those on rolls, church rolls, actually attend. So if you got 100 members, you'll probably average about 38. In my time, I've experienced that. I've seen that. That's been the case. Well, Dallas Willard, he said this in his book, in his chapter called Cost of Non-Discipleship. The vast majority of problems in churches today are caused by people who have not yet decided to follow Jesus. Probably waiting for a better deal. I mean, get a second opinion. Maybe, better wait to see. I've done some of that. I had done some of that. Because, see, if you take Jesus seriously, then it means you're not in control of your life. And everybody, just from our fallen nature, wants to act like I'm still here, I'm still kicking, I'm still in charge. So I can still decide if this is, in fact, the Word of God, or what parts are the Word of God, what parts aren't. I'm still wanting to be in charge, and that's where the lie always lives. Many are called, but few are chosen. What does this mean? Are you one of the chosen? Am I one of the chosen? Well, how can you tell if someone is chosen or not? Oh, here's another one. Does it really have to do with how they were dressed to be able to give witness to their chosenness? In the parable of the marriage banquet, Jesus gives us the history lesson, and it could apply to us individually as well as a congregation as well. The invited guests were the chosen people. That's why God came through Abraham. That's why he came through Israel. That's a chosen people to be a light to the Gentiles, to the rest of the world, to bring the whole world to God. And yet the chosen people, the Jewish people, at this point in this invitation, Jesus is making that because it's going to be them who kill him directly. And so he's invited the guests, the chosen people, that were the most moral, ethical, religious people on the planet at the time. And yet they refused to come to the banquet that the Lord had, of God Almighty, El Shaddai, the very one they profess to believe in. In verses 4 and 5, here in Matthew, then he sent some more servants and said, tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fattened cattle have been butchered. Everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet. But they paid no attention, went off, one to his field, one to his business. I couldn't help but think, because there's a lot of eating going on in the New Testament. Jesus feeds the 4,000, and one time 5,000. There's a lot of groceries, and there's a lot of meaning behind that the Lord uses revelatory to what it means to live in fellowship, in communion with him. And I couldn't help but think one went off to his business, and one went off to check out something else. And I couldn't help but think, here we are at Luke chapter 10, we're at Mary and Martha's house. And Martha's invited Jesus, and she's busy stirring the big pot, going to feed the bread of life. And Mary is sitting at the feet of Jesus. And Martha comes to her, don't you care that my sister is leaving me to do all the work? Don't you care? She's proven right then she doesn't know Jesus. Don't you care? He's the one to come from the highest heaven to save us. Don't you care? And Jesus says to her plainly but lovingly, Martha, Martha, you are troubled by many things. Mary has chosen the best part, and it will not be taken from her. Martha will finally get it in the gospel. She will finally come around, but we all have those moments when we think, hey, we ought to be doing this, and why didn't the Lord bless this and that, when we haven't taken the one thing needful, namely His word from Him Himself by the work of the Spirit. Martha, Martha, Luke, Luke, Moyer, Moyer, Cheryl, Cheryl, Lynn. We have to be careful. We have to be very careful about our business. Is it our business or is His business? If it's our business, then it's not His business. And so maybe I ought to rethink things. Maybe we ought to come to agreement with Him what is what and who is what and why. And then over here in verses 6 and 7, the rest seized his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his army, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Jesus says this over here in the next chapter, Matthew 24. Jesus had left the temple and was walking away when his disciples came up and to him to call attention to all these buildings in Jerusalem and the temple itself. Do you see all these things? Jesus said, I tell you the truth, not one stone will be left on another. Everyone will be thrown down. Jesus has prophesied 40 years before this is going to happen. 70 AD, the Roman army, God used the Roman army to come in. The general was Titus, and they tore down the temple and all these marvelous buildings because they wouldn't come to the banquet, if you will. They would not enter into a direct relationship with God. They were still holding out to do things by the law instead of by grace. We can't do the law, and that's pride still trying to live it out. And so here we have verse 8. Then he said to his servants, the wedding banquet is ready, but those invited did not deserve to come. Whoa. Did not deserve to come. Romans chapter 6, excuse me, chapter 9, verses 6 through 9. Listen to this. Paul writes, it is not as though God's word had failed. For not all who are descended from Israel are Israel. Nor because they are descendants are they all Abraham's children. On the contrary, it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. In other words, it is not natural children, biological children, who are God's children, but it is the children of the promise who are regarded as Abraham's offspring. For this was how the promise was stated. At the appointed time, I will return, and Sarah will have a son. So just being from Israel is it. See, we are now grafted in, according to Paul, and he explains that more in Romans. Christians, we are the new Israel. And converted, those converted Jews are part of the Israel that he is talking about. And so we can't just depend on our genealogy or anything of that nature. And then verses 9 and 10. Go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you find. So the servants went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, both good and bad. And the wedding hall was filled with the guests. That's the beauty of testimonies. That's the beauty of what's happening and should be happening. If we don't have a testimony, we might ask ourselves the question, do I really know Jesus? What has he done in my life? How can I express that to someone else? We can't. You can go a long way, some ways anyway, quoting scripture to somebody, but at some point they're going to wonder, well, you can quote all the scripture, but when did it impact your life in such a way you knew that was true? And so the verification comes relationally. It's still the same Holy Spirit incarnating himself in flesh and blood. It did in the Virgin Mary, and it happens in us, the new birth, John chapter 3, on and on and on. So invitation and testimony is critical. And then verse 11 and 12. But when the king came in to see the guest, he noticed a man there who was not wearing wedding clothes. Friend, he asked, how did you get in here without wedding clothes? The man was speechless. Well, it was customary in those times. Jesus is making note of that custom and the way it was done for wedding guests to be given garments. So everybody is the same. So nobody's up and above anybody else. All are the same. And it was unthinkable to refuse to wear these garments to the wedding banquet. That would insult the host, who could only assume that the guest was arrogant and thought he didn't need these garments, or that he did not want to take part in the wedding celebration. The wedding clothes pictures the righteousness needed to enter the kingdom of God. The total acceptance of God in God's eyes that Christ gives every believer through the shed blood of Christ, who alone has provided his righteousness, that we are clothed in, that we might be in his kingdom. Christ alone has provided this garment for everyone who will receive him on his terms in faith. But each person must put it on and live it out. There is an open invitation that we must be ready. In fact, the old saying is, those who wait till the 11th hour often die at 10:30. And then verse 11 through 13 again. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there was not wearing wedding clothes. Friends, he asked, how did you get in here without wedding clothes? The man was speechless. Then the king told the attendants, tie him hand and foot and throw him outside into the darkness, where there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are invited, but few are chosen. Oswald Chambers had a strong thing to say here. God can do nothing for me if I'm sufficient for myself. Pride is a sin of making self our God. So why would we need God? Another thing he said, Jesus Christ revealed that all humanity is evil. That's what he was saying about in Genesis chapter 2, 16 and 17. Do not eat the forbidden fruit or you will die. Evil enters in at that point. Jesus Christ revealed that all humanity is evil and that he came that he would clothe us with his very nature. He cannot do this until a person recognizes himself as Jesus sees him. Cannot help but think about the prodigal son, which is the story of the whole Bible, Luke 15. He's the younger son. He took all his and he went to the far country, riotous living on and on and on. He's in the pigsty, feasting on the pig's food, and he's a Jewish boy. You're not supposed to do that. And then he comes to himself. He came to himself. If we don't have a come to ourself moment, we're not coming home. And at that moment, he knew he could come home. Father, I've sinned against heaven and earth. I've sinned against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called a son. Make me a slave like your hired servants. And you know the story. The father, he's reaching out. He's bring my son the best robe. Put it on him. Kill the fattened calf. Put sandals on his feet. The ring on his fingers. And it is that restoration relationally with God. In Galatians chapter 3, verse 26 to 29, Paul writes, and he is a Jew of all Jew. He has more credentials of Jews than anybody. And he says, you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are all Abraham's seed and heirs according to his promise. For many are called, but few are chosen. Well, a pastor was called to go visit a man, elderly man who was dying. And he was bitter and frightened of death. The pastor quietly and tenderly spoke to him, shared with him the good news, the gospel about Jesus, about God's promise through Christ, the fellowship of God's people, the hope for life eternal. The man with a broken and whining voice complained, I've led a very busy life. I've just never had time for that sort of thing. Well, in his lifetime, he had 4,000 Sundays. If he went to a church that actually believed the Bible, he would have 4,000 invitations to know this Jesus. And that's the point. You can't have heaven without a hell. You can't have good news without bad news to be able to understand this. So heaven is a prepared place for a prepared people. And so it is. Hell is a prepared place for a prepared people. They were prepared not to accept Christ. And then John chapter 3. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but men love darkness instead of light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly that what he has been done through God. Wow. This is one of my favorite stories. It's a true story. And I believe it illustrates coming to the banquet. It's coming to the table with the Lord. To a more gathered my name, I am present. It illustrates it in a very simple way. And I have to wonder, because we're talking big heavenly things about banquet tables and stuff, but it's really in everyday life. How do we respond to the moment, to the presence of God, and to one another? The story, it came out of a minister's household about a guest preacher who came to the minister's house for Sunday dinner. And for this formal meal, the three children remained uncomfortably dressed in their Sunday best. Can you imagine? I can imagine. Mother and father took their places at either end of the long table, with the guest preacher and the 16-year-old son on one side and the 4-year-old and the 8-year-old daughters on the opposite side. The blessing was offered, the food was blessed. Immediately at its conclusion, the two young girls reached for the vegetables. That's when the accident happened. In their haste, the older girl's glass of iced tea was knocked over and its contents were spilled all over the table. The mother glared furiously at the two girls. Let's see, was her name Martha? Was her name Martha, maybe? The mother glared furiously at the two girls. The pastor, the father, who had been watching his wife's reaction, turned and looked at his daughters' heads, which hung in despair. Then the father, he knocked over his glass of iced tea. His son followed suit and knocked over his glass tea. Also, amazingly, the guest preacher knocked over his glass tea of iced tea. Iced tea from 4 glasses poured out on the floor. The poor pastor's wife surveyed the table, and yet she came to herself. Her anger faded, her frown curled into a smile, and she knocked over her glass of iced tea. Everyone at the table laughed except the 8-year-old girl. She had tears flowing down her cheeks. However, they were not tears of sadness. They were tears of gratitude and love. Her father had intervened on her behalf. He had shared in her mistake. He had shown real love. The father sent his son to take our sin. He became sin for us. The father's reaching out always, reaching out to receive those who will receive him. And he has sent us to give the invitation that he may be known. Many are called, few are chosen. And we can choose not to be chosen. But what a bad choice. Not just a bad choice for right now, but forever. Thanks be to God for his mercy that gives life, and it abundantly, life to overflowing, to be shared with others. Amen.